so I beg you to talk. Right, I'd like to welcome you all to this meeting of the Families and Wellbeing Policy and Performance Committee. I'm sitting in this chair tonight as Mortimer Coughlin is somewhere on the high seas. Who said that? And the first thing I've got to do is to invite members to declare any interest or quality living arrangements.
I've got a personal interest by virtue of my employment with Cheshire and Hampshire, but I think it's really nice and time.
Good. We move on to the minutes of our previous meeting, which are on pages 1 to 8. And I presume that everybody has read these prior to committee meeting. So if you're happy, I'll sign the minutes. Item 3 is a notice of motion that's been sent back to us from the council. It's on the mental health challenge, pages 9 to 10. And I think we've got Councillor Tom Anderson who is going to speak about this to us.
Thank you, Chair. I'd like to thank the committee for taking the time and consideration for this notice of motion. I won't take up too much of your time. I think the motion itself is quite descriptive. This is a challenge that's been given to local authorities by several leading mental health organisations, including mine, who will rethink Royal College of Psychologists. What it intends to do is put the mental health at the forefront and keep it in people's minds, so to speak, when considering policy. So what I would like the committee to do is endorse all the points on the notice of motion, the 10 things for the local authority to take hold of, and especially appointing a mental health champion. Now this can be a cabinet member, someone from the health or wellbeing board, or a backbench councillor, but it is an important role that this committee could ensure that we have. So mental health is what we're talking about dealing with external organisations. I'm happy to leave it there, Chair, as I say, it speaks for itself in the motion. I'm also happy to take any questions.
Does anybody want to make a comment or ask a question? Janette and then Treena.
So only a quick observation anyway, I think phrase with no brain was used on this one. It's a really sort of work-worthy cause. I'm sure with regards to mental health champion for me from our group, that I'm sure that will be not only well received, but probably quite a few volunteers and stuff for that. So yeah, it's got my support for you.
Yes, and Tom, you have my full support on this as well. You know, my son has gone with me through a lot of mental health problems, and so we have that on a personal issue. But the time to change pledge, is this the 10 points that are in the document itself? That is the pledge itself, yeah? Okay, thanks so much.
Water?
I think this was a good issue to raise over time. I think mental health services, in my opinion, have improved tremendously over the last few years. But do you think, like me, I still think that mental health is still a Cinderella service. It's not getting quite the impact, possibly with raising issues like this and bringing it to the attention of all to make us more proactive as a council.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I completely agree with all from that. Mental health is still considered stigma in some quarters. It was recently researched that someone with a mental health problem takes it on average about 7 years to admit they've got a problem and seek help. So this is what the Emergency Motion is intended to do, is bring services together, champion awareness, and say there's help there for you as well, working with all the farmers.
There was a recent developmental session in Farmers and Wellbeing which brought in a number of partners from across NHS partners but also partners in the voluntary sector to look at the mental health strategy, I guess, in the round. Clearly, social inclusion, employment, housing, there's a whole range of things that, as well as formal mental health services, that absolutely contribute to people's mental health. So I think, again, this is a very strong challenge, the kind of key elements of the challenge, the 10 key elements of the important elements. And we've got as a council need to work very broadly in order to be able to achieve the sorts of changes that are set out here. So I'm just really suggesting that this isn't necessarily just something that happens within mental health services that treat people for a short period of time when they're ill with a mental health problem. It's very much about taking a much more broader approach and the well-being elements within the internal challenges pick out pretty well.
Tony.
Yeah, I fully support the motion as well, and taking Janette's points on board, you know, a lot of people will be volunteers, become mental health champions. I know we've looked at it ourselves through the CHAMPS programme, but you can also become a mindful employer as well. You know, the council can become a mindful employer as a sign up to that charter also. And there's an option for people to become mental health first aiders, you know, so if you don't want to take the CHAMPS role on, you know, you can become a mental health first aider and get some training on that.
Can I come back on that? Thank you. I think that's expanded the role of the Emergency Motion having several champions, actually, which I would welcome. This isn't prescriptive, it's for local authorities to do what they best see fit, and that's an example for us. Councillor L Rennie and Williamson are having several champions. It would be helpful, though, to have one being champion, maybe a family member or someone on health and wellbeing role that has an overarching responsibility for this as well.
We can map that into the council chain, the council chain of councillors and support that role with the chain.
Alan,
do
you want to come in?
Yeah, just to quickly. Tom, in your notice of motion, you talk about the resources that various mental health charities could make available to the local authority. What sort of resources are we talking about?
There's a website called Mental Health Challenge. If you advise everyone to look at it, it's very good. And it has various briefing packs, resources that helps local authorities, lead members, to raise awareness of this issue, work with all the stakeholders, and have a holistic approach rather than, as Graham said, you know, just treating one symptom. It's about awareness of all that. So I've got one of the resources here. It's, you know, 10 questions for your council. And it actually asks them very pertinent questions on what they're actually doing for mental health, how many people are affected, what strategies are in place, do we see treatment in timeline and things like that. So I don't think that's for this committee to decide. It's not being too hard, but there are several.
Thank you.
Well, I get the impression that we're going to endorse this proposal, including an elected member as an informed health champion. So I think what we've got to do is to send this back to council, who will debate our recommendation. Is that correct? Yes. Anything else? Our next item 4, page 114, was an update of the county administration from the councillors.
In a similar way to the last item, the Mental Friendly Council initiative is something that was very much developed in the voluntary sector and delivered through the voluntary sector framework, but that very much encouraged councils and others to get involved in the programme.
Could you possibly put your microphone on? Because I can't hear what you're saying. Thank you very much.
Excuse me, who said that?
Me, sorry.
I'm sorry, you can't interject.
I've got a microphone on that. So, the initiative came out of the voluntary sector, but clearly as council, we were very keen to progress a number of elements of the dementia friendly programme as a council to support the voluntary sector. So these are set out in the bullets at the top of the background of the sheet. So encouraging council staff to become dementia friends, working with the Alzheimer's Society in terms of working out how to support them, looking if necessary for council properties to be used for the training sessions of the dementia programme. Encouraging elected members to become dementia friends and inviting key council staff to become dementia friendly champions. So below this we've got a number of actions that are taking place. Now it was quite interesting in terms of responding to the notice of motion, because some of the areas that are in the notice of motion the Alzheimer's Society had taken care of in quite some detail themselves. So for example, the facilities to run sessions and the number of sessions that they've put in place have all been dealt with by the society themselves. So they have developed a very comprehensive programme of developmental events. One of the things that we've done is ensure that those sessions are advertised, if you like, that's part of an early briefing. But also a broad briefing that will come out to councillors very soon. And it does say that the data will be circulated to members in August, but I think that's happened as yet, has it? I'm not sure. It has? Okay, that's happened. Cool. So those data have been circulated as far as I'm aware. So in essence, what you've got here is an update in terms of the actions. It really is something that is very easy to do. I'm a dementia friend. It's very easy to register. The information that comes through from the society is interesting and helpful. You can go further and go to the next level and you become very, very involved as a supporter of dementia. So some information here for people to share to ask any questions.
I've just got a comment. I was unable to open the letter to the heads of offices on the website.
Oh, right. I'm not sure what's happened there, so I'll find out what's happened in the technical sense.
Yours. Any comments or questions? Wendy.
Thank you, Chair. I also am a double dementia friend a bit. I put my face-to-face training also. I did wonder whether it might not have been easier, because it's been promoted to all council staff to do, that the council couldn't have facilitated a few in-house sessions that were in a building where people already were, and they could just attend simply. And how many council staff so far are trained, and in what kind of workplaces are they within the council?
There have been a number of training events outside of this programme, but in terms of dementia awareness. So as I understand it, some good staff have been trained in terms of dementia awareness, not as a formal part of this programme, but as a part of training in terms of their roles. And that's been I understand that also as part of this that we have been looking at whether to open that to members as well in terms of their training. Again, that would sit alongside the programme as opposed to us kind of the programme on behalf of the part time of the society.
No further questions or comments? Recommendations that we never to report. Item 6 is I want to try this to what I'm saying. Item 5, I will say, is to safeguard your annual report. We've got Simon Garner to speak to us.
Slides, and there are, and I'm going to apologise for the fact there are eight of them. represents the work that's been done. So the annual report is looking back over the last year and saying, well, what are the things that you set out to do and have you done them? And some of them will have perhaps more meaning than others to you, but the domestic abuse subgroups focus heavily on making sure that people have an understanding of what constitutes domestic abuse, how you get help for somebody who needs it in relation to that, child or adult, and also, you know, what the range of services are that sit behind agencies that may come into contact with people who experience domestic abuse. And it's recognising that largely models that we have for working with families tend to be about separating relationships where this occurs rather than looking at other alternative approaches. And that's a national issue. So a lot of the work in terms of devising a strategy, ensuring that procedures for assessing and devising training are about what we're going to launch this year that we're going to do and evaluate. So we now have something to take forward in terms of a plan for this year, and we would expect in a year's time to be talking to you about what difference these things have made, this strategy and these measures, to the lives of families. But one of the things that is a sort of live strategy that we've had some experience of already is Operation Encompass. People familiar with Operation Encompass? So this is a Merseyside initiative. It's a partnership between police, local authority and schools. And it's about where it's been identified as been an incident overnight. Children involved, their school will be contacted. We will ensure that the staff at school have an understanding of what's happened for that child and they can support them in a different way to what would happen if they just went back to school in distress state. So this is about providing a new type of support intervention to children at a much earlier stage. This is something you'll, I'm sure, be very familiar with. This is a year when we have a very big national campaign launched on the 18th of March as part of the Merseyside group that works together with the police and health services and other partners. A lot of promotional work was done. You may have seen some screenshots on your computers at one time. You may have seen posters. There's been an awful lot of material that we basically harnessed the resources of the region to be able to do a lot more around promoting awareness and how we're all acting on its own. So it's been a really good opportunity for us to join up and take advantage of collective skills and resources. The campaign featured a number of radio interviews as well as briefings, as we say, posters and leaflets there. I was part of one of the radio interviews. Very big group of children from across the region, very different groups, some of them were Parliament young people, some of them were young people who'd been in care, or from the Children in Care Council, and all of them were saying very similar things about children need to understand about this earlier, and kids need to be helped to understand, they need to talk to somebody and who that person can be. It's really important, it's not always easy for the kids, and they said this themselves, to talk to parents about this for a number of reasons, although they should be encouraged to, but it's about helping them to see that there is somebody there that they can talk to. And going forward this year, we have a small drama local theatre group that's been heavily influenced by this production, national production, Chelsea's Choice, that we have in Wirral. They are going to be going out to schools to continue that education across more of a range of young people and schools, because we only targeted one year on the CH, and we only looked at year 9 children. That is the group that comes up that we're working with, but that's often when risks have already taken place. I think I just wanted to mention about this poster and tell you a bit of a story about it. One of the most vulnerable groups, I suppose, we have are those that are placed out of borough in residential homes. And in relation to this group, we wrote to the home providers. These are Wirral children, perhaps placed in Leeds, Huddersfield, somewhere out of the area. And we said, come on, what are you doing about the children that are in your homes? How are you responding to this issue? So they did some work with the kids and the staff, made sure the staff were trained, and responded positively to our inquiry. We don't manage those homes, and we might only have one child in them, but it's a good response. One of the young people said, I know about this, I want to do a poster, I want to tell other kids what to watch out for. So this was a direct consequence of that. She agreed to it being shared, and it's now part of kind of Merseyside toolkit of what is put out there for kids to learn from. So it's a really, really positive bit of engagement. We have changed one or two bits just so it's clear, and you can see all the people writing on it, but she is really trying to share some of the obvious kind of points where things can go wrong if you're not thinking things through. So I would say in relation to the CSE, we've got some good intelligence around what's going on. We know where the patches are and where this happens. We're developing tools to help social workers assess situations and non-professionals, non-social workers, understand whether this might be CSE or CE. We're listening and consulting to children. We've got a range of referrals, which is good this year. We're seeing more referrals come from different sources, so it shows we're getting out there. But there is an awful lot more to do. It's a much bigger problem than we all realised, as came out recently in some of the national reports. Okay. In terms of neglect, again, this is about a set of tools, strategies that have been developed this year that will really influence practice going forward. And what I would say is the key thing is about having a common lens to look through, so we understand what we're looking at, regardless of what badge we're wearing professionally, that we can identify and see where neglect is happening, and in particular when it's gone on too long. So the points of intervention are right for every family, particularly for every child. And the pathway ensures an early response, because we all understand that it's the time that neglect has been experienced and disadvantage over that time that makes the recovery so much more difficult, particularly in education. Learning and improvement as a whole, subcommittee that looks at this of folk that have really worked hard to get a solid training program together around safeguarding and evaluate that in a really meaningful way, because we've been talking to people much more about, well, you did the training course, you said you learned some things, what difference did it make when you went back to work? What's the so what factor for you? Did it change your practice? Did it change things? So they've really pushed forward on that, and we're starting to see more evidence of the impact of training rather than how many people attended which course and did they think it was any good. But alongside that, we've introduced a new framework. You'll see the word SCI there, SCI, that Social Care Institute for Excellence. It's a framework based on that national model, which is about getting at some of those situations earlier where a serious incident hasn't occurred, but there is some definite learning from the way in which we've delivered services collectively across agencies. Having done a couple of them, they are a little bit easier in that people are more comfortable sharing. Things haven't quite gone wrong yet. And so we can learn now before they do and get the learning out much quicker, because there's no investigative report, there's no long lead-in to finding out what went wrong. We actually get people around the table, we have a discussion about what happened, we decide what we need to do differently, and we get that message out quickly. So that's really important, that the learning loop is closed much quicker. And we actually do more of this work. The more we do, the less likely we are to have And these are some of the examples of what has come out in terms of learning from serious case review. This is how we share that learning by actually getting some of the key points out very simply to people who have had some trouble.
Thank you.
The effectiveness of early help, again, I'm not going to spend too long on this because it is one of those areas where the work this year is focused on establishing partnerships, developing multi-agency strategies, setting up the data set. I would say the data set is good, it's got a good distance measure tool on it that really helps understand if the family started here, what are they saying about where they are now and how has life changed for them. We call this priority signs of safety, but it's probably more commonly referred to as strengthening families, because there are now a range of models for working with families where you're trying to look for those signs that they have within them to keep their own kids safe, those strengths that they have themselves to build on. This was based on a couple of gentlemen from abroad, I think it was Australia if I remember right, who worked with social workers and families and developed a model from the ground up about what would be more effective in engaging families to work with a child protection plan, more effective to engage families in what they need to change and do differently. So quite a simple approach. It was developed, it's been gone international really, but what the key is that you develop it locally. So it's not pick it off the shelf and let's do the training on this. It should be, how do you decide what you need in rural for rural families? So that's the course we've embarked on. And it is going to be 18 months before we have a final model, but that won't stop us introducing things along the way that enable us to work better with children who are subject to a child protection plan. This is just a little bit of background about the infrastructure that sits behind and supports some of the work, the joint protocols we have, the support we have online for every agency that works with us on the safeguarding group. All the schools have access to an online audit solution, helps them self-assess themselves whether they're match fit in this area of safeguarding. And we have developed the use of Twitter. We have about 500 followers, and today we have an event before the board met this morning, development day, and we were busy tweeting some key messages that other agencies who couldn't be there will be able to pick up on Twitter. So it's using some of the sort of modern means of communicating what some of the key things are that we need to say. So in terms of our annual business, I'll just whiz through this because the work we do around finding out where people are in their own organisation, performance-wise with safeguarding, we have a means of assessing that, that's reported to the board. There are meetings that the director and the chair, independent chair of the board have to challenge agencies around how they are presenting their audit of themselves, their self-assessment. I've talked about learning from case reviews. We do practice audits, which are about looking not at single agency, but multi-agency responses to children to see whether or not people are understanding thresholds, people are working correctly with policies. We have a child death overview panel. We received an annual report this afternoon about that. And what's really key about that is understanding, well, if these deaths are happening for children, are there specific strategies, campaigns we need to run in rural to prevent things like child deaths through overlaying and so on. Okay. People familiar with the local authority designated officer? Most of the work is in schools, that's where their allegations meet professionals. Very busy job. This is the business plan then going forward. This year. This is what we've agreed as a board we're going to focus on. Four priorities, safeguarding is everybody's business. And we're going to be particularly looking at thresholds and compliance with thresholds, people in understanding of when children are at risk. We're going to be launching a website, so it's much easier if you're out there and you want to check a policy, know what work is going on in a particular area, just know who to talk to about something. That's going to be launched later this year. I've talked quite a bit about child sexual exploitation. There is a lot more work to be done. We are particularly interested in checking what difference you make with all this work at CSC. So as I said before, we're going to be looking at how the things we've put in place to really help actually have an impact, the same as we use. And this area is an additional priority we agree today around medicalisation. It's a growing concern nationally. It's something we need to work on across both of the safeguarding groups, adults and children. And there is currently a channel panel set up to deal with specific referrals where we may need to do some preventive work. So that's a summary of the annual report. Apologies, it's only in draft, so it's not published yet, but we will let you know how and when you can access that and make sure that's available through a link to each of you.
Thank you. Right, I've got David first. Uto.
Yes, sir.
They can't speak together. Silent first.
Is it okay if I stay up here?
Might be easier.
Thank you, Chair. Just curious, having worked in a previous life for soccer and now the National Crime Agency, I'm just wondering what connections and what interface you have with Cllr, for instance. Because I know when I worked there was a real attempt to outreach, particularly around training, of anybody who was interested. I'm just curious, I've not mentioned it, I'm just wondering, is there an interface there between the council and Cllr?
Cllr being?
Child exploitation online protection.
Ah, right.
Sorry, forgive me, I would have thought you'd have known that.
Just checking that we're talking about the same thing. There is a group, a subgroup of the board that has been working on, in particular, issues of e-safety. So I know they've done some work on that. I haven't got the detail with me, but it has been a significant issue, and I know that they are linked with Cllr. One of the things that we ran earlier in the year was questionnaires with primary school, top-end primary school kids. And it was a bit shocking, really, the extent to which they were accessing and using the internet in such a way without having a clear understanding of some of the risks and what they shared. So I know that that work has been going on. I think it would be useful for us to check redraft at the moment whether it's something so we can put in specifically about that. So thank you.
I think, Chair, it was just you wouldn't want to reinvent the wheel if it already existed. I mean, that was the only concern I had, because you're obviously working extremely hard on several fronts there, and I just think there's an awful lot that Cllr have done over the years that you could probably steal the pride, really, to be honest, and that's what works.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Who's first?
Thanks, Chair. I'll just speak loudly, if that's okay. Firstly, can I just commend the training that I delivered on child sexual exploitation? If there's any councillors that have attended, and we have councillors, I can't recommend it enough. It's a real growing concern in society. I was just thinking, because I'm really concerned about domestic abuse as well, as part of this child sexual exploitation. I don't know what we can do in primary schools, I'm not aware of our limits. I'd like to see a programme rolled out in primary schools that starts at an early age with age-appropriate training, just about appropriate relationships, about body confidence, about tackling at a really young age and dealing with children in a way that they can comprehend. It's not too scary for them. Because I think that's, especially young girls, I have to say, that girls, body confidence issues, they're being bombarded by the media with very sexualized graphic images of, teenage girls and pop stars. And do you think that, in my mind, I think that's connected to low self-esteem and what they'll accept in the relationships. But I don't know what we can use local authority to try and run anything out in primary school, so that would be really useful. You could tell me.
I think it starts with a conversation, doesn't it, with the heads, and I'm with them next week talking about prevent and radicalisation, but I think it starts with a conversation with the heads that are about those sorts of issues and what's the kind of education around that that we can support. So I'll pick that up.
Yeah. Because I know it's not, I mean, I know you can't make them, it's not on a curriculum, national curriculum.
No.
And it's a shame, really, because I'm sure we'd all want to see that on the national curriculum, because that to me is as important as any academic area of study as this. But in the absence of it being on the national curriculum, it would be good to use. Make that part of your conversation.
So it's a sort of, it's kind of taking what some of the work we've done in high school and saying what's the measure, what would be the right level,
and
what are some of the issues around that age that fit with that concern.
Yeah.
Thanks, Jenny. I completely agree with Councillor Williamson that it does need to start with the curriculum very early on in primary schools. I did go up to see Chelsea's Choice, and it was an amazing theatre production of child sexual exploitation. My concern with that was I have a son that attends a Catholic school, and it was not rolled out to the Catholic school, so I would like to see that happen. Also, you mentioned about Twitter accounts. We'd just like to know the name of your Twitter account so we can tweet away and, to our residents and you know, children and all. So, if you can have that as well, please, that'd be great.
Okay, that's me. I'm going to put this in the it's down to WS.
Sorry, what was that?
WSCP.
WSCP.
CP. As in, we're all safeguarding children's board. But just the.
Oh, right.
Just
the
initials.
Okay, thank you.
Wendy.
Thank you. I think we all appreciate you coming, Simon, because safeguarding children is obviously dear to all of our hearts and such a vital thing. And Chelsea's Choice was extremely powerful for drama when I saw it. But also the Willow Youth Theatre, the stuff they're putting together around that is also incredibly powerful. So I wish them every success as they move forward in putting that out to schools and so on. So just want to say thank you. It's an important piece of work.
Thanks, Simon. I thought that was excellent. Just do you have a feel? Where would Wirral be in terms of safeguarding? Do you think we're in the upper quartile of local authorities in the way that we operate? And perhaps also linked to that, given the financial situation the country finds itself in, are we, in terms of resources, both within the council and within the various agencies that operate in this area, have we got sufficient resources? Have you seen a reduction in, or is it increasing even? Where do you think we are actually placed at the moment?